Hi, let's talk about erythrocytes. Erythrocytes, or red blood cells, are biconcave discs that are helpful for carrying oxygen and carbon dioxide throughout the cardiovascular system. There are approximately 5 million red blood cells in every microliter of blood. And on average, these are between 7 to 8 micrometers in diameter. When you think about the average diameter of a capillary bed as about 10 micrometers, you can imagine that these red blood cells are going through capillary beds single file. Probably of most importance to a red blood cell is the protein hemoglobin. Hemoglobin is a heterotetramer, meaning that it is a protein comprised of four subunits, each subunit containing a heme group where oxygen can reversibly bind. There are approximately 280 million hemoglobin molecules in every erythrocyte. And erythrocytes as a cell are highly specialized. They're not like other cells of the body. As such, they lack nuclei, they lack mitochondria, they are very reduced in terms of their overall cellular organization, but they do have a lot of hemoglobin. Probably the most efficient way of thinking of an erythrocyte is as a little bag of hemoglobin. Hemoglobin accounts for about a third of the mass of an erythrocyte, and if you were to dehydrate an erythrocyte or take away all the water, hemoglobin would be approximately 96% of the mass of an erythrocyte. Because hemoglobin is important for transporting oxygen, we might therefore conclude that the primary duty of an erythrocyte is to transport oxygen, and we would be correct in that assumption. Erythrocytes have a shelf life. It's approximately 120 days. After that time, erythrocytes are filtered out by organs such as the spleen. Erythrocytes may be produced on demand to meet the body's needs for oxygen. We think of erythrocytes as being hypoxia dependent, meaning whenever levels of blood oxygen decrease, there are specialized peptide hormones, such as erythropoietin, or EPO, and transcription factors, such as hypoxia-inducible factors, or HIFs, that are secreted within the kidneys, released within the blood, and red blood cells, or erythrocytes, are produced. This process takes approximately 10 days from start to finish. So, one might imagine that if they were to board an aircraft at sea level and be transported to a high altitude, such as Denver, Colorado, that within their kidneys, they would start to release erythropoietin and these hypoxia-inducible factors that would, within 10 days, help to elevate the hematocrit. Hematocrit is a fancy word that means the percentage of red blood cells that are available. By having an elevated hematocrit, the blood is capable of transporting more oxygen to help the body meet its energetic needs. Erythrocytes function through the reversible binding of oxygen to the heme groups of hemoglobin. There are four heme groups within hemoglobin, and that represents the opportunity for oxygen to be loaded onto that molecule within the erythrocyte. Also, erythrocytes have the capacity of carrying carbon dioxide, perhaps in the form of bicarbonate ion or carbonic acid, or even as carbon dioxide, as we've discussed previously in the carbonic acid bicarbonate ion buffer system. Hemoglobin, hemoglobin, is a cooperation between two major elements. The heme groups, the center of which contains iron, and various globin proteins. The polypeptides that comprise hemoglobin may be varied, and we refer to them with Greek letters, alpha, beta, delta, gamma, and so on. The two most frequent subunits that we find in hemoglobin are alpha and beta subunits. And so there's a particular type of hemoglobin called hemoglobin A, which oftentimes is referred to as adult hemoglobin, which comprises about 97 to 98% of the total of adult hemoglobin. With regards to hematocrit, whenever the volume of red blood cells falls, an individual might be suffering from anemia. A, meaning without, and emia, blood, literally meaning without blood. Anemia is a very large concept that can be broken down into many different types of anemias of various etiologies or causes. All of these etiologies have one thing in common, and that's the reduced capacity of the blood to carry oxygen. These etiologies may be dietary in nature. An individual might not be getting enough iron in their diet so that they're not forming enough heme groups. It might be a physiological limitation for that individual to absorb the iron or to even biologically incorporate it into other molecules. The anemia might be a disorder of the successful production of healthy red blood cells, or it might be as simple as a hemorrhage, where the volume of blood decreases, and following that, plasma bounces back rather rapidly. But if you recall, EPO, takes about 10 days in order to manufacture more red blood cells. And so an individual following hemorrhage might be somewhat anemic. On the other side of the spectrum, an individual might be polycythemic, and that is having an elevated hematocrit to the point of danger. With too many red blood cells, an individual is at risk for spontaneous coagulation, which would lead to ischemia, which could possibly lead to necrosis and possibly death. On the surface of erythrocytes are a number of different molecular enhancements. They may be proteinaceous, they may be lipidous in nature, they might be associations of lipids and sugars, and all of these molecular enhancements serve various functions. Oftentimes, we might categorize or group an individual's blood by these surface elements. And one of the more popular ways of doing so is with the ABO blood group. With the ABO blood group, there are certain surface membrane antigens, either A or B, or both A and B, or the complete lack of those surface membrane antigens, which help us to categorize the blood. So there are four major blood types: type A, type B, type AB, and type O. There are two surface antigens and their various distributions that help us to type within the ABO blood group. Those surface antigens are the A and the B antigen, and an individual might have only the A antigen, in which case they are type A. They may have only the B antigen, in which case they are type B. They may have both antigens, in which case they are type AB, or they may have neither antigen, in which case they are type O, or originally thought of as zero. Complementing these surface antigens are serum antibodies for whichever antigen the individual does not have. So for instance, an individual who is type A has serum anti-B antibodies. An individual who is type B has serum anti-A antibodies. An individual who is type AB has no anti-A or anti-B antibodies. And an individual who is type O has both anti-A and anti-B antibodies. Now, an antibody is a protein with variable sites that can interact with antigens. And an antibody may bind or agglutinate molecules together, or an antibody may call in what's known as a complement response or reaction, in which case the cell and all surrounding tissues can be destroyed by the immune system. In the case of the ABO blood group, these antibodies are agglutinators. And what can happen is, if someone is not careful when performing a transfusion of blood or blood products, there can be a cross-reaction. So for instance, if an individual who is type A receives blood products from a donor who is type B, we can have agglutination. Likewise, if an individual who is type B receives blood products from someone who is type A, we can have agglutination. If an individual is type AB, they're considered the universal recipient. They can receive blood from any of the blood types. And an individual who is type O, they can only receive blood from other individuals who are type O. They receive blood from individuals that are A, B, or AB, they're going to have agglutination responses. These individuals who are type O are special, however, because their erythrocytes don't have any surface isoantigens, meaning they can be donated to any of the other blood types. And whereas type AB was seen as the universal recipient, type O, as a blood type, is the universal donor. Another form of blood typing involves a surface antigen known as the Rh factor. The Rh factor was first isolated in rhesus monkeys. That's why we call it the Rh factor. And an individual either has the Rh factor, meaning they are Rh positive, or they do not have the Rh factor, in which case they are Rh negative. As you can imagine, this can be layered onto the ABO blood type as well. So an individual might be A positive, or A negative, or O positive, or O negative, and so on and so forth. The largest clinical significance of the Rh factor involves mothers who are Rh negative. So what can happen is a woman who is Rh negative might conceive a child with a partner who is Rh positive. And it's therefore conceivable that the fetus and the subsequent embryo might be Rh positive. Well, what can happen is during the first pregnancy, in the placenta, where we have mixing of mother and child's blood, this Rh negative mother is exposed to the Rh factor for the first time, and she might start producing anti-Rh antibodies. And in subsequent pregnancies, these anti-Rh antibodies can travel across the placenta and into the bloodstream of the developing fetus and embryo and mount an immune response against it that could be deadly. Thankfully, science has engineered a cure for this in the form of a substance called Rogam. With Rogam, a woman who is Rh negative receives a series of injections, and this prevents her body from ever forming these anti-Rh factor antibodies. And so she can proceed with this pregnancy and subsequent pregnancies without jeopardizing the health of the developing child. The condition of having these anti-Rh antibodies attacking a developing embryo is known as hemolytic disease of the newborn, and it has been nearly eliminated thanks to the development of Rogam. So we've discussed red blood cells, their components, their functions, their clinical applications. Let's go on in future lessons to see how other constituents of the blood, such as leukocytes or white blood cells, and thrombocytes, may also function. Thank you.